Welcome to SATU Career 2.0 online nursing channel. In today's video, we are going to see nursing officer exam important questions for BHU, AIIMS, Bhatinda, PGIMS Rohtak and NIMHANS nursing officer exam 2019. Watch all the 50 questions in this video so that it is going to be important for you in the future exams. Let's see the first question of the day. The nurse is aware that children born with a missing chromosome are most likely to have option A, cretinism, option B, phenylketonuria, option C, Down syndrome, and D, Turner syndrome. So guess the right answer. Children who is born with missing chromosome are likely to have option D, Turner syndrome. Question number 2. Which is earliest gastrointestinal manifestation of cystic fibrosis in a newborn? Option A, pancreatic fibrosis. Option B, deficiency of fat-soluble vitamins like A, D, E and K. Option C, intestinal obstruction. Option D, meconium ileus. So in case of cystic fibrosis, the earliest GI manifestation would be, again, option D is right, meconium ileus. Question number 3. When performing a physical assessment of a newborn baby with Down syndrome, the nurse suspects that the infant may have option A, bulging fontanelle, option B, stiff lower extremities, option C, abnormal heart sounds, option D, unusual papillary reactions. The right answer, during the assessment of a newborn with Down syndrome, the nurse suspect for, the right answer is stiff lower extremities. Move on to question number 4. A parent of 1 year old child reports that my infant tastes salty when kissed. Nurse would expect the probable diagnosis would be option A, cystic fibrosis, option B, Rice syndrome, option B, leukemia, option D, multiple sclerosis. So the baby, the parents feel the salty taste while kissing the newborn. This is because of which condition? The right answer is option A, cystic fibrosis. Question number 5. G6PD, glucose 6 phosphate dehydrogenase deficiency is classified in the following trait. Option A, autosomal dominant. Option B, dominant X-linked. Option C, autosomal recessive. Option D, recessive sex-linked. So in which trait there is deficiency of glucose 6-phosphate dehydrogenase? The right answer is option D, recessive sex-linked. Now move on to 6th question. For the visual hallucinations are seen in the lesion of option A, occipital, option B, temporal lobe, C, parietal lobe, D, frontal lobe. So the visual hallucinations which is formed is seen due to the lesion of option B, temporal region of the brain. Question number 7. Which of the following is not a probable sign of pregnancy? Option A, vaginal discharge. Option B, fetal heart rate detected by a non-electric device. Option C, Chadwick sign. Option D, uterine contraction. So which is not a probable sign of pregnancy? The right answer is option B, fetal heart rate detected by a non-electric device. Question number 8. Which value of HbA1c in a diabetic patient is indication of good control of blood sugar level. Option A, 1, 2, 3. B, 6 to 8. C, 8 to 10. Option D, 10 to 12. The value of HbA1c in a diabetic patient, which is a good indicator of a good blood sugar control level, will be, the right answer is option B, 6 to 8. Question number 9. How do you know the intercostal drainage tube is functioning? Option A, continuous bubbling in water sealed bottle. Option B, continuous bubbling from suction tube. Option C, oscillation of water column in drainage bottle. Option D, no bubbling in the drainage bottle. So how you know that intercostal drainage tube is functioning? The right answer is option C, oscillation of water column in the drainage bottle indicates that intercostal drainage tube is functioning well. Question number 10. Which of the following is the ideal way for a standard organization to retain the motivation of its competent employees? Option A, competent pay scale. Option B, transparent policies. Option C, free education for children. Option D, free healthcare facilities. The right answer, the thing which is helping to retain and motivation of the competent employee will be option B, transparent policies. Question number 11. The best method to remove cerumen from a client ear involves option A, inserting a cotton tip applicator into the external canal. Option B, irrigating the ear gently. Option C, using oral suction. Option D, using a cerumen curette. So which is the best method to remove the cerumen from the client's ear? The right answer is irrigating the ear gently is the first important method to remove the cerumen impaction. Next question. To enhance the percutaneous absorption of nitroglycerin ointment, it would be most important for the nurse to select a site. That is, which of the following? Option A, muscular. B, near the heart. C, non-hairy. Option D, over a bony prominences. So the right important place where you can keep the percutaneous nitroglycerin ointment to is option C, non-hairy area. Question number 13. A newborn is suspected of having a hydrocephalus. For which symptoms would the nursery nurse monitor the child? Select all that apply. Option A, sunset eyes. B, depressed fontanelles. C, increase in head circumference. Option D, head circumference is equal to the chest circumference. Option D, thin scalp and sparse hair. So what a nurse can suspect in a newborn, whether he or she is having a hydrocephalus? The right answer would be option A, sunset eyes. Option C, increase in head circumference. Option E, thin scalp and sparse hair. These three symptoms indicates a child is having hydrocephalus condition. Question number 14. The laboratory values of an adult male client reveal the presence of hepatitis B surface antigens and hepatitis B antibodies. Which of the following laboratory results should the nurse also expect to see? select all that, apply. So apart from these, like hepatitis B surface antigen, hepatitis B antibodies in a laboratory value, what are the other things a nurse would expect to see? Option A, elevated serum albumin. Option B, low serum globulin. Option C, elevated serum transaminase like ALT and AST. Option D, prolonged prothrombin time. Option D, low urine bilirubin. The right answer, option C and D, elevated serum transaminase and prolonged prothrombin time also should be noted in the laboratory value for any significant findings. Question number 15. The nurse is obtaining a health history for a client with osteoporosis. The nurse should specifically ask the client about which of the following. Select all that apply. Option A, amount of alcohol consumed daily. Option B, use of antacids. Option C, dietary intake of fiber. Option D, use of vitamin K supplements. Option E, intake of fruit juices. So while collecting history of a client with osteoporosis, the nurse should specifically ask for option B, use of antacids and daily dietary intake of fibers. Next question. The client's stools are light gray in color. The nurse should assess the client further for which of the following? Option A, intolerance of fatty foods. Option B, fever. Option C, jaundice. Option D, pain at McBurney's point. Option D, respiratory distress. Which is the right answer? The right answer is option A, intolerance to fatty foods and jaundice, to be noticed by the nurse when you see the client is having a light gray in color stools. Question number 17. Which of the following is significant data to gather from a client who has been diagnosed with pneumonia? Select all that apply. Option A, quality of breath sounds. B, presence of bowel sounds. C, occurrence of chest pain. Option D, amount of peripheral edema. Option D, color of nail buds. The right answer, in case of pneumonia, you should see for the quality of breath sounds. Option D, amount of peripheral edema. Now we move on to 18th question. The nurse is teaching a client with Raynaud's phenomena. To prevent having vasospasms, the nurse should discuss which of the following lifestyle changes with this client. Select all that apply. Option A, stop smoking. B, exercise finger by using the keyboard or playing the piano. Option C, beer mittens when taking food out of the freezer. Option D, warm up the car before driving in cold weather. Option E, stop vasospasm by putting the affected part in ice water. Let's see the answer. Option A, a client with Raynaud phenomena should not smoke. Next thing, they should keep their body warm. So they want to keep the car warm before they drive in a cold weather. And they should always wear a mitten whenever they are taking a chill, cool food from the freezer. So these three things they should do. Next question. A client is admitted for gastrointestinal bleeding. He has a platelet count of 15,000 millimeter and platelets have been ordered from the blood bank. Which of the following does the nurse know are required for platelet transfusion? Select all that apply. Option A, ABO compatibility, option B, RH compatibility, option C, cross matching, option D, a specialized platelet filter. So the nurse needs to have option D, a specialized platelet filter is necessary when you are going to transfuse platelet. Question number 20. The nurse is preparing to administer blood to a client who requires postoperative blood replacement. The nurse should use a blood administration set that has a, option A, micro mesh filter, option B, non-filter blood administration set, option C, special leukocyte poor filter, option D, micro drip administration set. So what are the things a nurse should keep when you are going to administer blood in a post-operative client for replacement? The right answer, it is very important to keep micro mesh filter. Question number 21. The nurse is admitting a client who is jaundiced due to pancreatic cancer. The nurse should give the highest priority to which of the following needs? Option A, nutrition. Option B, self-image. C, skin integrity. Option D, urinary elimination. The highest priority in a pancreatic cancer client who is having jaundice would be option A, providing good nutrition. Question number 22. The nurse is preparing to administer a tuberculin Montauk skin test to a client suspected of having tuberculosis. The nurse knows that the test will reveal which of the following. Option A, how long the client has been infected with tuberculosis. Option B, active tuberculosis infection. Option C, latent tuberculosis infection. Option D, whether the client has been infected with tuberculosis bacteria or not. The right answer, the tuberculosis test will indicate whether the client has been infected with TB bacteria or not. Question number 23. The nurse caring for a client at night insists that client cannot tolerate the ordered intermittent tube feedings. The primary nurse should first, option A, suggest that an antiemetic be prescribed. Option B, change the feeding schedule to omit nights. Option C, request that the type of solution be changed. Option D, gather more data from the night nurse about the technique use. So in this case, what a nurse should do first? The right answer is, so here the nurse will be going for we want to go for administering the feeding during the daytime. So option B is right here. The rationale here, rapid administration is incorrect. Positioning and inadequate solution temperature are common causes of intolerance to tube feeding. So option B is right. Question number 24. During a mass disaster drill simulating a terrorist attack, the nurse must triage numerous severely ill persons. The client who should receive care first? Option A, cyanotic and not breathing. Option B, gasping for breath and not conscious. Option C, apneic and has an apical rate of 50. Option D, having a seizure and is incontinent of urine. The right answer is, the nurse first rescue the client who is having gasping for breath and who is not conscious. So I have given the rationale here. You can read the rationale. We are going to next question. Thrombus formation is a danger for all postoperative clients. The nurse should act independently to prevent this complication by option A, assisting the client to exercise in bed. Option B, urging the client to drink more fluids. Option C, applying elastic stockings to client's legs. Option D, massaging the client's extremities gently with lotion. So what a nurse should do to prevent this complication when he is having a thrombus formation in the postoperative period? The right answer is, the nurse should assist the client to exercise in bed. So we are skipping the rational explanation. You can read the rational which is given in the slide. Question number 26. After a cardiac catheterization, the client complains of tingling sensation in the affected leg. What the nurse should do first? Option A, assess for bleeding at the catheter insertion site. Option B, evaluate the affected leg for signs of inflammation. Option C, compare the femoral, popliteal and pedal pulses in both legs. Option D, obtain the temperature, pulse, respiration and blood pressure. So what a nurse should do here? The right answer is, the nurse should compare the femoral pulses, also the popliteal and pedal pulses in both the legs. Question number 27. A high school football coach is admitted to the coronary care unit with a tentative diagnosis of myocardial infarction. While assessing the client's pain, the nurse would probably expect him to describe it as option A, severe intense chest pain, option B, a burning sensation of short duration, option C, mild chest pain radiating to the fingers, option D, excusing chest pain relieved by nitroglycerin. So which is the right answer? The right answer is option A, the chest pain has the qualities like it is severe and it is going to be intense. Option A is right. Question number 28. After surgery for fractured hip, a client complains of pain. The nurse should option A, notify the physician. Option B, use distraction techniques. Option C, medicate the client as ordered. Option D, perform a complete pain assessment. So what you know should do here? The right answer is perform for complete pain assessment. You can read the rational here. Because of short duration of time, I am skipping the rational. Question number 29. When teaching about the dietary control of gout, the nurse is aware that the dietary teaching is understood when the client states, I will avoid eating. Option A, eggs. B, shellfish. Option C, fried poultry. Option D, cottage cheese. The right answer. So a patient who is having a diet which is controlling the gout should avoid eating shellfish. Question number 30. A client's right tibia is fractured in an automobile collision and a cast is applied to assess for damage to a major blood vessels from the fractured tibia. The nurse should monitor the client for option A, swelling of the right thigh, B, an increased blood pressure, option C, increased skin temperature of the foot, option D, prolonged reperfusion of the toes after blanching. So the nurse should monitor the client for option D, prolonged reperfusion of the toes after blanching. Question number 31. A client with acute renal failure moves into the diuretic phase after 1 week of therapy. During this phase, the client must be assess for signs of developing option A, renal failure, B, hypovolemia, C, hyperkalemia, D, metabolic acidosis. So in this case, the nurse must be noting that client is having the signs of hypovolemia or not. In diuretic phase, this is common complication. Question number 32. To which collaborative healthcare team member should the nurse refer the client in the late stages of myasthenia? Option A, occupational therapist. B, occupational therapist. C, recreational therapist. Option D, speech therapist. The right answer, the nurse should refer the client in the late stages of myasthenia gravis to the speech therapist. Question number 33. A nurse is assisting a physician with the removal of a chest tube. The nurse is most appropriately instructs the client to option A, perform Valsalva maneuver. Option B, inhale and exhale quickly. Option C, exhale as the tube is pulled out. Option D, stay very still. So in case of assisting in the removal of chest tube, the nurse should instruct the client for performing Valsalva maneuver. Question number 34. Which referral would be most important for the client with permanent hearing loss? Option A, speech therapist. Option B, occasional rehabilitation. Option D, oral rehabilitation. The right answer is refer to oral rehabilitation. Question number 35. A client has just undergone insertion of central venous catheter at the bedside. A nurse would be sure to check the results of which of the following before increasing the flow rate of IV solution attached to the line. Option A, portable chest x-ray. Option B, serum electrolytes. Option C, serum osmolarity. Option D, intake output chart. The right answer, the nurse should check for the portable chest x-ray. Question number 36. A nurse is preparing to care for a client with a K deficit. The nurse reviews the clients and determines that the client is at risk for developing the K deficit because the client, option A, is on nasogastric suction. Option B, is on potassium sparing diuretics. Option C, has a history of renal disease. Option D, has a history of Addison's disease. So related to K deficit, the nurse should review the client's record. And the right answer is, because the client is in nasogastric suction, so there is chance for the client to develop K deficit. Question number 37. A nurse plans care for a client with COPD. Knowing that the client is most likely to experience what type of acid-base balance? Option A, respiratory acidosis. B, metabolic acidosis. C, respiratory alkalosis. And D is metabolic alkalosis. The right answer will be option A, respiratory acidosis is most common complication when a client is having COPD. Question number 38. The most common cause of retinal detachment is A, trauma. B, diabetes mellitus. C, degenerative changes in the retina and vitreous. Option D, brain tumors. So in case of retinal detachment, the right answer, you should find the trauma as the major cause. Question number 39. After 48 hours, successful fluid resuscitation of a burn victim can be evaluated by option A, urine output, B, peripheral perfusion, C, weight, and D, urine specific gravity. The right answer, option A, urine output has to be evaluated for knowing the fluid resuscitation is successful or not. Question number 40. A nurse is teaching a new hemodialysis client. Hemodialysis is successful in the treatment of end-stage renal disease because option A, it mimics renal function. Option B, it restores urinary ability. Option C, it restores renal endocrine function. Option D, it improves immune function. What is the right answer? The right answer, option A, the hemodialysis will mimic the renal function. Question number 41. Which of the following atrial blood gas values is consistent with metabolic acidosis? Option A, partial pressure of oxygen of 90%. Option B, carbon dioxide 48 mm of mercury, bicarbonate 16%, and option D is pH of 7.35. So which of the atrial blood gas value is consistent with metabolic acidosis? The right answer is the bicarbonate 16% is consistent in metabolic acidosis. 42. The nurse noticed that breath sound is diminished on both lung bases of the patient with chronic obstructive pulmonary disease. The patient also presented with rapid breathing, pale lips, cold, clammy skin. Which of the tests should the nurse expect the physician to order to determine if the intubation is necessary? Option A, peak flow meter. Option B, partial oxygen saturation in arterial blood gas. Option C, oxygen saturation in pulse oximeter. Option D, lung function test. The right answer is oxygen saturation in pulse oximeter has to be checked. Question number 43. The nurse is assigned to monitor a patient who has a tracheostomy tube in place. During assessment, the nurse notes a pulsation in the tracheostomy tube and heavy bleeding from the stoma. The nurse understands that the patient has developed option A, tracheoesophageal fistula, option B, tracheomalacia, option C, trachea innominate artery fistula, option D, tracheal stenosis. So here, the nurse understands the patient has developed a complication called trachea innominate artery fistula. So the rationale is given. You can read and get clarified with this. Question number 44. The nurse assigned at the psychiatric unit read a drug component with acetylcholine. Which of the following best describes the physiologic and mental effects of acetylcholine? Option A, pain perception and muscle relaxation. Option B, stimulates the body's fight or flight response. Option C, regulates sleep and depressed mood states. Option D, stimulates regulation of learning and memory. So acetylcholine is associated with option D. It stimulates the regulation of learning and memory. Question number 45. The nurse is caring for the patient with delirium. Which of the following is not an appropriate nursing diagnosis for this condition? Option A, acute confusion. B, chronic confusion. C, sensory perceptual alteration. Option D, risk for injury, which is not an appropriate nursing diagnosis related to delirium. The right answer is, delirium is always an acute state of altered consciousness. So chronic confusion is not an appropriate nursing diagnosis here. Question number 46. The nurse is caring for the patient with narcolepsy. Which of the following is true about this condition? Option A, difficulty sleeping. Option B, disruption of sleeping pattern. Option C, daytime attack of sleepiness. Option D, has disturbed sleep leading to insomnia or excessive sleepiness that results to sleep related breathing condition. So which statement is true about narcolepsy? The right answer, narcolepsy is associated with daytime sleepiness. Question number 47. The nurse is caring for the patient who demonstrates olfactory hallucination. This is commonly seen in what condition? Option A, delirium. B, schizophrenia. C, schizoid disorder. Option D, acute alcohol withdrawal. So olfactory hallucination is commonly seen in seizures disorder. Question number 48. The granddaughter of the patient asked the nurse if it is normal for elderly people to feel sleepy despite sleeping for long hours. Which of the following condition would the nurse suspect? Option A, somatoform disorder. B, malingering. C, anxiety. D, amnesia. The right answer is option B, malingering, which is associated with prolonged sleep in elderly people beyond the normal limit of sleeping. Question number 49. The patient presents with severe angina and ST segment elevation on the electrocardiogram. In terms of diagnostic laboratory testing, the nurse expects the physician to order option A, creatinine kinase level. B, hemoglobin level. C, troponin level. Option D, liver panel. So in case of severe angina and ST segment elevation in electrocardiogram, a diagnostic test to be ordered by the physician will be troponin level assessment. Question number 50. The patient with gastric cancer is complaining of pain with scale of 3 for 10 and reported to be increasing in intensity. Which medication is most likely given to the patient? Option A, Tylenol. B, codeine. C, hydrocodone. Option D, morphine. So the answer is given here directly. Tylenol is given as the first treatment of choice in a patient with gastric cancer. So rational is given here. You can read the rational so that you get clear understanding why Tylenol is given here. So we have completed all the 50 questions in this video. Hope this is very useful for you. And if you like this video, please like the video and comment about this video in the comment box. Thank you all for watching this video. Meet you again soon with another 50 questions which will be very important and very useful for your future nursing officer exams. Thank you. Bye-bye.